Good morning. My name is Jeff Clark with the Advanced Power Alliance, and I thank you all for being with us today. It's a real pleasure for me and for my colleagues at APA to help host this event, which we think is not only vitally important, but timely as we begin to assess the damage caused to our energy systems last week and the economic fallout from those. I think every Texan is very happy as we begin to get back to normal. We're struggling to assess the human impacts of last week, but we're also asking two very important questions. One, what happened? And then second, how do we ensure that the things that occurred last week in our energy system never happen again? I'm very thankful that Conservative Texans for Energy Innovation partnered with us on this event. We work closely with Matt Welch and his team, and they are making sure that the energy discussion in Texas is one that includes all perspectives, and they bring a very vital perspective to the conversation. So thank you, Matt, and your team for working with us. I also want to thank Steve Scheibel and our communications team at New West Communications, who have done a tremendous job helping us organize this event. Again, we think it's vital. As anyone who's read the newspapers or watched the media or listened to the radio over the last few weeks has heard our guests, and I'm very thankful to each of you also for being with us. I think you have expertise that we will all benefit from today. I'm going to introduce each of them briefly, and then we'll open, and then what we are focused on today is making sure that we answer as many questions as possible from the audience. And I'd ask you, if you have questions, I have a list of questions that were submitted by our registrants. I've tried to compile those into general themes so that we can cover the main questions that have been asked. If you have additional questions, I would ask you to use the chat function. I would encourage you to keep your comments civil, focused on the facts, and focused on solutions or the problem at hand. We want to make this as transparent and as open as possible. So we will not be filtering the Q&A or the chat function unless absolutely necessary, but do keep it civil. And our time is limited, but we'll do our best to answer as many questions as we possibly can. So again, thank you for being here, and thank you, Conservative Texans for Energy Innovation, for partnering with us on this. Let me first introduce Allison Silverstein. Allison is a consultant. She's a strategist, she's a writer. I think anyone who works in energy knows her name, or certainly has read some of her work. She's written some of the most influential papers on system reliability and resilience, which is a main focus of our work today. She worked on the US Department of Energy's report on electric markets and reliability, congestion studies, and the list goes on and on. She was also a senior advisor to FERC Commission Chairman Pat Wood, from 2001 to 2004. And of course, we know Pat from his work at the federal level, but also his work in Texas. Second, please meet Dr. Daniel Cohan. Dan is an associate professor of civil and environmental engineering at Rice University. He teaches courses on atmospheric sciences, energy, and the environment. He has a BA from Harvard and a PhD in atmospheric chemistry from Georgia Tech. And he specializes in the development of petrochemical models and their application to air quality management and impacts on energy use, air quality, and climate. And Dan, thank you as well for being here and for your expertise. Dr. Joshua Rhodes is a research associate at the University of Texas at Austin and a founding partner of IdeaSmiths. We have worked with him in the past on a number of very influential studies about the Texas grid. He has a double bachelor's in mathematics and economics from Stephen F. Austin, a master's in computational mathematics from Texas A&M, a master's of architectural engineering from UT Austin, a PhD in civil engineering from UT Austin. And I think Josh is attempting apparently to go to every major college in the state. His current work is focused on smart grids and our bulk electric system, and including energy efficiency, resource planning, distributed generation, and storage. And then finally, let me introduce Michael Jewell. Michael is one of the leading authorities on energy law and policy. He is a fixture around the Capitol in Austin, where lawmakers look to him for guidance on policies that are very, very complicated. And he is a voice not only of expertise, but has the ability to bring the language into that environment in a way that people can understand. He was a Plan 2 major at UT and received his law degree from UT Austin, and works with a number of clients. And I came to know Michael when he worked for Governor George W. Bush on public utility issues at the Capitol. So again, Michael, Dan, Allison, Josh, thank you again, all four of you, for being here. And I'd like to kick off, before I do that, let me remind you, this is just an example of how much influence they have had literally on networks around the country, but also internationally. These are the voices that are bringing an expert opinion to this conversation. So again, thank you all four for being with us. And let me kick off the conversation with Josh, Dr. Rhodes. We all lived through the events of last week. My family was without power and water. We all suffered in various degrees, and some obviously we've seen the loss of life in the state. We know the tragedy, but many of us don't understand the scale of the energy impact and how it affected our energy systems. Can you give us some perspective on the scale of this crisis?
Yeah, so my name is Joshua Rhodes. Thanks for being here. I'll try to give a kind of a broad overview of kind of, you know, what happened. And, you know, what we saw in Texas, was a colder, deeper, wider amount of weather that we've really, you know, ever seen. We've had cold weather and we've had events that have led to failures before, but this one was colder and wider and longer, lasted longer than previous events. And the electricity system is like any other market in terms of you have to match supply and demand. But the thing about the electricity system is you have to match supply and demand in real time. And so if demand and supply get out of whack, you have to bring them back level or the entire system will go down. And if the entire system goes down, then that can take weeks, if not months, to turn back on. So what we saw as the cold Arctic mass came in is we saw an extreme increase in the demand for heating in Texas, as you know, everyone was wanting to stay warm. About 60% of homes in Texas use electricity, 40% use for natural gas. And we just saw an extremely high amount of heating. Now, we meet peak demands like this in the summer all the time, you know, mid 70 gigawatts worth of electricity demand for air conditioning. We meet those, you know, demands on regular. The difference between this event and that event is there was competition in the natural gas system. So while, you know, power plants were wanting to consume natural gas to make that electricity, homes were also wanting to consume natural gas for heating. And at the same time, our supply out of West Texas, we had some wells freeze off, some gathering lines freeze, and we weren't able to put more gas into the system. And we ended up short on the natural gas system. So some power plants couldn't get gas. Some other power plants also had freezing issues with cooling water or sensors or all kinds of things. When it all came down to it, you know, we lost about 40% of our thermal fleet during the time when, you know, we were, you know, demanding the most amount from both of these systems. And so both of these energy systems are interrelated in the wintertime because we're using gas for both, but both of them were just pushed beyond, you know, what we have, you know, currently designed them for. That's kind of a high level view of kind of what happened, and we ended up in the dark.
Dan, from your perspective, as you watched from Houston, what professional observations did you have about the event?
Right. So I was watching it with the lights on, feeling a bit of survivor guilt that somehow we were on a line that kept power and one block away they didn't. So it was all of us going through a lot. Of course, couldn't drink the water for a few days, and my wife treating more carbon monoxide poisonings than she's seen in her entire career. So it was really a tragedy and disaster on a human level in so many ways. I think we need to keep track of that while also, you know, as subject experts talking about what we know about the systems. I really see this as a systems crisis and a failure on three levels, is that the markets failed us, the regulations failed us, and the energy systems failed us. As a professor of environmental engineering, I'll focus mainly on the energy systems here. And what we saw was the unique vulnerabilities of our gas system and our electricity system to each other, that we need gas for 2/3 of our power supply in the times of peak demand when we need it most. and gas needs electricity to move. And so when one teeters, the other falls on top of each other, and we had these cascading failures where suddenly when we needed power the most, we lost 40% of it. And I think utilities were prepared to, you know, have rolling blackouts, have slight outages, but 40% goes down and you need to supply power to hospitals and fire stations and so on. And instead of a 15-minute rolling blackout, we had millions left in the dark for days. And I think it exposed unique vulnerabilities. We definitely saw the vulnerabilities in every single piece of supply. We had wind turbines that froze up. We had coal plants that went down, even though we put up with their pollution year round because they're supposed to be there at the toughest time. We had one of our four nuclear units freeze or couldn't operate because its water supply froze. But dwarfing all the rest of those combined was the fact that our gas system went down, both because plants were down for maintenance, plants hadn't weatherized themselves, but really a supply issue of not being able to get enough gas to those plants that tells me that this can only be fixed if we look at this as full energy systems. If the state legislature, the PUC, the Railroad Commission are all part of fixing this, more than just ERCOT can fix alone. So I'll leave it there, and I'm sure much more will come up in questions. Thanks.
It sounds like, Dan, you pointed out that there was no generation system that escaped the ice and the cold from this storm, that it was but the focus, you know, that we saw that interconnectedness begin to break. Allison, right. Where do you see the problem lying?
Well, I want to pick up on and expand Dan's comment about the systems issue. Two of the interdependencies one of them has been long recognized in terms of cascading interdependencies and failures. And one of them that most of us have personally experienced is the loss of freezing water that froze everybody's pipes and caused a lot of people's pipes and caused the failure of safe water supplies and destroyed a lot of people's homes with frozen pipes. But the other one, and that was directly attributable to the level of cold and the loss of electricity to keep all of our personal stuff, houses warm so the stuff wouldn't freeze at the start. But the other one that we haven't appreciated that could have made a difference here is our dependence in the electric and gas systems on transportation and frankly, passable roadways. One of the things that we underappreciate here in Texas is that there were two storms, I know it all, or three storms. There was a full week of bad weather. Governor Abbott declared a state of emergency and sort of an anticipatory disaster declaration on February 12th, because the first set of ice storms was coming in and hitting the bulk of the state. Most Texas cities only plan on one heavy winter storm per year, and that storm is likely to produce a teeny bit of ice and a half an inch of snow. And outside West Texas, we all think that's more than enough. Cities only stop up to treat that small amount. And so when the first storm came in on Thursday night and Friday, many cities used up the entirety of their winter road clearing stores. And they don't have stuff like snow removal equipment in most cities. So by the time this next massive storm and extended end-to-end statewide set of bad weather hit for multiple days, there was no way to get the roads clear. And so you can't get crews out to start doing late remedial fixing on a plant or on a pipeline or helping to open up, unfreeze a wellhead or an entire field if your people are stuck inside and they have to get out on horrible roadways. They can't get equipment. Our entire society is kind of just in time in terms of repair equipment and the like. So our ability to fix a lot of the things that broke after the first storm and in the second storm was significantly reduced because people couldn't get around and they couldn't get all the supplies that they needed to fix stuff.
You remind me that our first series of outages in Austin, at least, were related to transmission problems and things that involved repairing those lines. In states that we work in outside of Texas, we actually had to intervene with the state and ask for prioritization of roads to get to the wind farms and get those lines back up and running. That's an excellent point. Michael, I'm going to pivot to you. I want to take a question that was submitted by Christopher. And I'll just read the question. Was this a generation problem or a transmission problem? And I think we're beginning to identify some of that. A generation problem or a transmission problem or both? And the second question was, are renewables reliable enough to handle these extreme circumstances? You want to share your thoughts on that question?
No, I appreciate it, Jeff, and thank you very much. Appreciate the opportunity to be here this morning. I mean, I think fundamentally it's both at the outset. It was generation and transmission. The key issue that we saw was a cascading problem throughout the generation fleet. You know, the wind turbines had problems with ice. The gas turbines had problems with freezing. They had problems with supply, nuclear, problems with water. I mean, it was kind of a problem throughout the entire fleet. At the same time, there were times where transmission, you know, on the wholesale level was a problem as well. There were times that I'd be watching what was going on the ERCOT map, and you would see pockets of generation that was going, but it could not move that energy from where it was being generated to load centers. And that seemed to happen to all resources. You know, it seemed to have wind in the panhandle, solar down by the Gulf of Mexico. I suspect it was a cogen facility down around the Gulf area. I mean, so we clearly saw, again, problems with regard to the transmission grid as well, just within ERCOT. So that is all, it's an all of the above problem. With regard to wind, you know, going into this event, and I mean, at the outset, we all understand wind and solar are intermittent resources. You got to rely on when the wind is blowing and when the sun is shining. And ERCOT has done a wonderful job of being able to take advantage of wind energy, solar energy, and using all of the different technologies that we have to generate electricity to provide the lowest cost energy to the citizens and to our businesses. Those low costs have enabled a lot of economic development to come back into the state. In this particular case, ERCOT actually, you know, had not been expecting that much wind to be supporting the grid at the time of the winter peak. And so, you know, did it have problems with icing? Absolutely. Did that adversely impact the generation? Absolutely. But when you look at the magnitude of that impact versus the impact on other generation, the other generation far outstrips the impacts, you know, to the grid than what we saw on, you know, adverse impacts to wind and solar.
I'm going to put a question before the whole group, and it's a question directly related to this interdependency of energy systems, because the question comes from Matthew. It's clear we're focused on interdependency. Given that, doesn't it make sense? Why are we focused solely on electricity generation? And I think that refers to the dialogue that's taken place among our public officials. What agency regulates gas pipelines? Should all of these regulatory agencies be at the table?
Yes, they should. Just checking to make sure. Absolutely. I'm not muted. There is the Public Utility Commission, there is the Railroad Commission, there is the Texas, Council on Environmental Quality or something like that. But so we have environmental regulators, we have gas regulators, we have electric regulators, we have the governor's office. But let us be clear that the state legislature has passed the bulk of the statutes and policy direction that all of these agencies are supposed to implement. If the legislature fails to mandate weatherization of pipelines or of power plants, there are limits to how far the regulatory agencies can go to step beyond where the legislature has given them direction. If the PUC sets up and ERCOT implements a market that encourages high prices to incent, scarcity pricing to incent performance, ERCOT and the LET regulators are not doing that purely because they are horrible people with evil designs who are captured by the generation or the fossil community. They're doing it because that's what the legislature told them to do in statutes that were well thought out and negotiated by well-meaning people 20 years ago. So it's not as though regulators fell asleep at the switch. They have very clear policies that worked for Texas for a long time. Every policy that is passed in by statutes, traditionally, you find unintended consequences. There are ways that you could have implemented them better, but this is not some grand cabal that intended to screw everything up. I will say, to close this set of ideas, regulators need to coordinate much better, and they need to show a lot more creativity and imagination and stretch the bounds of the statutes they've been given. Thank you.
And just to put it,
Jeff, I'd like to add,
let's go to Dan. Start with Dan and then Michael.
Yeah, just very brief, and yeah, spot on everything Allison said. Just to put it a bit more bluntly, the buck stops with the state legislature. You know, we're a state with a weak governor system. We've kept the federal regulators out of our business. Each other agency only addresses one piece of the problem. ERCOT with the power grid, Railroad Commission with the oil and gas pipelines. This is going to need a fix from the state legislature. The legislature's in session for its one time in 2 years, and that's where solutions must come from.
And our policies have deliberately held back regulation. Texas sort of philosophically wants as little and as weak regulatory intervention as possible. And now we're reaping that bitter harvest.
Yeah, Jeff, the one thing I'd like to add, Jeff, is, you know, we do have these different agencies that have different aspects, but I think we've got to tip our hat to the work that they did on working together this time. You had the TCEQ these were lessons learned, I think, from 2011. You had the TCEQ taking actions to provide greater flexibility to be sure the generators could run all out. You had the Railroad Commission prioritizing gas for generation resources. You had the chairman of the commission, you know, reaching out to them as well. So, I mean, are there lessons to be learned here from that perspective? Absolutely. But I do at least want to tip my hat to, they did a good, you know, they did a lot of work of working together in really difficult circumstances.
And we had the Department of Energy also coming in and allowing us to run units ahead of the storm, as you said, to allow people to run all out in the face of what we knew was going to be a challenging storm. I have two questions that are related to ERCOT, and I'm going to open them up for the group and just encourage you to discuss them. Number one, the question from Tom, the board resignations at ERCOT, politically, they were great news that was big news yesterday, but it seems, Tom's question, the board resignations seem to have robbed ERCOT of a lot of expertise. Was that a good thing? Question number one. Second question is, I think we were alluding to it a moment ago, it's becoming increasingly clear that ERCOT, in the face of a lot of systems that had not been properly planned for, became aware that we were on the brink of losing the entire grid. And I think it's becoming increasingly clear that they acted very, very quickly to preserve us from a complete blackout and what's known as a black start. A question that has come in is how difficult is it to restore the system from a black start? How severe of a consequence would that have been? So two questions about ERCOT's performance and board.
I can take the operational question and the collapse and black start issue. And speaking from our experience reviewing the August 2003 Northeast blackout, I want to applaud ERCOT's operators and management for not hesitating. When they saw the both frequency and voltage collapsing, they did what they had to do to start dropping load in order to prevent a worse blackout that very likely would have cascaded and collapsed the entire ERCOT grid. These events, the black start is the least of the problems. ERCOT and its generator and transmission partners rehearse black start regularly, as does every other system in the world. The challenge is that when you have a collapse of the nature that we were facing, with plants having to rip off because of the system, because the entire electrical as opposed to infrastructure, but the actual power, as things start going down, what happens is all of the thermal generators that have rotating mass have essentially get thrown off with no warning whatsoever. And what this can do, and what it has done historically in the 2003 blackout and others, is it can rip up pieces of the actual power plant. And what that means is we already had a bunch of generators that had disconnected because they were frozen and unable to keep generating. But those were managed disconnects. When you get an unmanaged sudden drop of the kind that a collapse would have triggered, this can cause significant damage, and you can't start a power plant until you have checked to see everything that is wrong and fixed it. And that takes a long time. And if there had actually been physical problems and destruction to, you know, 50% or more, 60% of ERCOT's fleet is thermal and would have needed to be checked. And the more of those were out of service, the worse we would have been in terms of our ability to paste the system back together on top of challenged equipment delivery, roads, communications, everything in shambles. So ERCOT operators did the absolute right thing. When you get to an actual black start, if all of your equipment is working, that is just a piecing things together. And in ordinary circumstances, without weather challenges and loss of 40% of your generation, you can do that within a day or two maximum, because probably much smaller for ERCOT because we're not a large system. But under the context of so many weather-related icing losses and the like, it could have taken a long time, and it would have taken even more because of the need to check all the potential equipment for damage.
Yeah, and Jeff, just following up on that one point, the estimate that I'd heard is it could take up to 6 months to restore the grid.
Devastating.
And that presumes damages, I believe.
Yeah, I think there's certainly the technicians and the folks who were at the control center at that moment. I think we should tip a hat to them for acting aggressively in that moment, despite what is obvious now. There have been failures throughout the system. As we wrap up, what happened and what were the failures? Have we left anything uncovered that before we move on and start talking about solutions?
Yeah, I wanted to get to the point about the board resignations and things like that. I mean, systems on this level are extremely complex, and it's not like there's not a bunch of smart people in Texas, but it is helpful to have outside views. I think I don't think just firing people because they don't physically live in Texas makes sense in this scenario. I mean, it wasn't like they were, not buying in or not working hard because their homes weren't affected by this. But it's also, I mean, it robbed us of expertise of areas that do get cold winter weather more often. I mean, if we just have people within Texas, I mean, we generally think about the summer, and that's fine because that's usually when most of our stuff is happening. But like, we kind of are robbing ourselves or limiting our pool of qualified folks if we, require them to be here for kind of superficial reasons.
Go ahead, Michael.
No, what I was going to say is that in addition, the four board members who resigned, the one who withdrew their petition for approval, are all the independent board members. And that independence, it plays a key role in ensuring a balanced management of the board of the grid. And so, can you find independent people in Texas? Absolutely. But you can also find a lot of independent people outside of Texas who don't have the same skin in the game, if you will, as folks in Texas. So that independence is really key, and we do not need to.
As we wrap up an assessment of what happened and the causes for what happened, it is apparent that we had a lack of appreciation for the interdependence of our systems, a lack of weatherization perhaps, and people have pointed to this storm and said, well, we never would have expected a storm of this size, never could have seen an event like this ever coming. Clearly there was a failure of imagination in assessing what a potential storm would look like. But were there other issues, Allison?
I want to go back to the failure of imagination. This industry has been treating extreme weather events as though they are what the industry calls high impact, low frequency. In other words, something very bad happens and affects a lot of people in a horrible way, but it doesn't happen very often and it's highly improbable. And we tend to view all of these events as extreme weather events as high impact, low frequency. And we have not done anywhere near enough planning and thought about how bad could it get. Other industries, the Department of Defense War Games, and it thinks about every possible creative disaster, horrible thing that could happen. And they start thinking, what if that happens? What should I do? In the case of ERCOT, I and many others have been telling them for years, you should be starting to think about extreme weather events that we know are getting worse demonstrably, regardless of your viewpoint on climate change and cause. Texas is in the gun sights for an awful lot of extreme weather, and extreme weather is getting worse and worse. We designed this entire grid for Ozzie and Harriet weather. We are already facing Mad Max, and it's getting worse. So we need to be deliberately doing the kind of analysis and anticipation that folks like PJM have done superbly in looking at just how thinking extraordinarily broadly about extreme weather events that are much worse than anything that we have historically experienced, and starting to plan around what does that look like, how bad could it be? Because in my view, extreme weather events are no longer high impact, low frequency for Texas. They're high impact, medium frequency. We can absolutely predict bad stuff is going to happen. We just don't know all the parameters of it. So we did not do that kind of planning, and we must do it for summer and winter and hurricanes and everything else going forward starting tomorrow. Well, better yet, starting 5 years ago.
I think Allison is spot on in calling this a failure of imagination. And I think it's also a failure to appreciate correlated risks. And it, as I've said elsewhere, this just reminds me of watching The Big Short all over again, where we slice up our risks, we slice up our pieces, and we assume that, you know, like the financial whiz kids assumed, if they packaged a subprime mortgage from Las Vegas together with one from Miami, together with one from Detroit, one of those pieces might fail, but the overall system would carry through. And what we saw in the planning here was accounting for the potential of one failure or a few failures at a time, is they had one scenario where wind output might go down. They had one scenario where demand might go up. They had one scenario where we might have more scheduled maintenance. One scenario where, since we have a couple of hundreds literally of gas power plants, it was assumed that those are, you know, what we might call uncorrelated errors or uncorrelated risks, where, you know, if you're spreading your risk over a few hundred plants, then there's no way that 40% of them could go down at once, because we didn't realize that one unique vulnerability of gas, that it's the one fuel that needs a continuous supply of fuel sent in from hundreds of miles away. And so we didn't realize that every single one of those things could fail at once and cascade upon each other. And we're left with blackouts that were a scale on the order of 500 times the amount of forced outages, the amount of supply shortfall that California experienced in its wildfires. We were left with 1 week of power costs that cost as much as 3 years of generation combined, even when it was keeping so many in the dark. So when we treat these as separate and we don't plan for how extreme events, and this time it was an Arctic blast, but climate events, summertime, you know, hurricanes, floods, droughts are more likely to be our next events than a deep cold event. They can stress all these systems in the same way, especially when demand for gas and electricity peak at the same time.
I agree with everything Dan said, except one, when he said we didn't realize that our dependence on gas. Sure, we did. I had my power out in 2011 because the gas system froze up and the electric system and a bunch of gas plants froze up. We all knew this. We just didn't bother to act on it and to plan around the inevitability of this happening again.
And Dan, you talked about the need to move fuel to the gas plants and that vulnerability that exists. We talked about icing at gas plants, talked about icing we lost, as you said, one of our nuclear reactors. But coal sometimes gets a pass on reliability. I joke that coal is the the burly friend who is unpleasant in some ways, but can always be relied upon to work when you need work done. But even in this instance, how did Cole perform? Have we seen impacts of the storm on Cole?
Right. Cole failed us as well. I mean, Cole output should be at its max. Coal and gas should be at their max when demand is at its max. And coal actually fell in its output during the storm. And I'm waiting to see the data at the end of the month to find out exactly which plants stumbled. I mean, I know even, you know, newer plants like spruce, their output fell precipitously during this.
Despite the rhetoric that we've heard over the last few years about on-site fuel and all of the, we saw
Rick Perry said, piles that were frozen. Because they've got, you know, a 60-day supply of coal on hand. I don't know why it failed this time, but I know in the past, having a 60-day supply of coal on hand doesn't help you if the coal gets waterlogged in a hurricane. And it doesn't help you if either the coal pile freezes or the equipment that you need to get the coal off of the pile freezes. It doesn't help when the machinery at the plant doesn't work. It doesn't help when you're in drought and your water supply evaporates, or a freeze and your water supply freezes up. So I think, you know, ERCOT has called these firm operational resources and assumed they would be there for us. We put up with their pollution year round in the idea that they will keep the lights on. My research has shown that, you know, a number of these plants are responsible for over 100 deaths a year because TCEQ has allowed them, some of these, to operate without a single scrubber on them, without controlling their sulfur at all. That's been required nationwide for any new plant built since 1981. TCEQ doesn't require them in 2021 and just issued a regional haze proposal that would do zero about it for the next decade. And so why are we putting up with this pollution, this health, this climate change, these deaths, when they aren't even there for us when we need them?
Yeah, and you know, there's a bunch of different ways to slice up the data over, you know, that the period where, you know, many millions of Texans were without power and what we were expecting to have. I mean, you know, our thermal fleet was down tens of thousands of megawatts. And like, you know, it was there's a terawatt hour of like energy that was not sent out to folks. And so, I mean, it was large. I mean, our, you know, coal fleet maybe was roughly down around, you know, 6,000 megawatts, and natural gas 18,000. You know, it's big numbers. It's numbers that would have made a difference if we'd have been able to, you know, get that energy to homes. I mean, we still might have had some blackouts, but they might have been actually rolling like they said they'd be in that case.
The second part of our program was to focus on who's to blame, and then I want to move to solutions. But I want to make a statement and then get some quick feedback and then move on to solutions. But I think it's becoming abundantly clear that for commercial reasons or political reasons or, you know, whatever reason, there are individuals or entities trying to assign blame to any one sector. The fact of the matter is we have a systemic failure. At least that's what I'm hearing. And I ask you to disagree and share your thoughts, but it seems like we have a holistic failure that needs to be addressed in our planning, in our weatherization, in our transmission, in our generation. It's really a failure of all of the above. Agree, disagree?
Yeah, I mean,
You first, Josh.
Thank you. So, I mean, it's, you know, our system is easier to think about in the summer. And we do a lot of thinking about the summer. That's typically, again, kind of where we think, but it's more linear in the summer. The gas goes to the power plants. The power plants make electricity, and the electricity goes to homes for air conditioning. But in this case, in the wintertime, the gas and the electricity sector are so much more coupled together, as we've seen, and, you know, introduce these, you know, these complexities and make it somewhat harder to plan, because instead of having, it's not like we couldn't have seen some of this coming, but instead of having just a linear plan, it's more interconnected, which makes it, you know, harder to know, well, if this happens, then this may affect this thing, which then may affect this thing, which relies on this thing. And that's just more complicated than this relies on this in general.
And one question that has just come through the chat from Stacy relates to water, which is the one component we've not spoken, but thermal generation often relies on water. Our nuclear plant problem was related to water. Clearly, does our water system need to be part of this conversation as well?
Sure. But let's go back to the who's to blame issue, because it underlies the water as well as the power issues. Everyone, you know, in the movies and on TV, there's always like one villain or one schmuck whose ineptitude caused the problem. There are no villains here. I think everyone, if you want to know who's to blame, it's all of us. Look in the mirror. It's not just the legislature. It's not just the people at ERCOT or the folks on the board or the public utility commissioners. It's every one of us who was the telephone regulation term is fat, dumb, and happy, FDH. It's all of us who sat down enjoying our cheap energy and our cheap natural gas and our cheap water for so long, rather than being aware that the cost of this could go up and not pushing our regulators or our politicians to take aggressive action to reduce the pollution from coal or to raise costs by requiring better winterization of the pipeline system and the gas production system and the power plants. We set up a bunch of rules that very deliberately said, give me the cheapest possible electricity and gas and water I can get, and don't trouble me about any of that other stuff. And then when all of the assumptions that set up the system that people of competence and mostly goodwill followed the rules they were given, everything failed at once, but it was predictable and semi-inevitable. And we are forgetting that we spent decades enjoying very cheap electricity and very cheap natural gas and not bothering to spend money on energy efficiency and distributed generation and pollution controls, because that's what we wanted and that's what our politicians told our regulators to deliver and told ERCOT to manage. So it's not just about that bad guy over there. We all share a piece of this blame.
Have we benefited?
Two very brief points about water, if I could.
Please, Dan. Yeah.
One is we're seeing an exact mirror of our problem with electricity and our gas systems, is that we've hardened them, we've weatherized them, we've prepared them for summer. Summer is when we expect them to be most vulnerable. And so when cities went out and bought generators to be sure they had backup for the next hurricane so that drinking water systems wouldn't go down again like they did in Hurricane Harvey, they didn't bother to get generators that could withstand the cold. So they seized up and didn't work. They weren't winterized, just like every other piece of the electricity was. The second thing I think it teaches us is just how our systems across society depend on electricity, and inevitably in some ways depend on electricity, is that, you know, you can't operate drinking water systems, cell phones, you know, hospital devices, everything else without electricity. And so it just adds to the compounding reasons of why we need to keep our electricity reliable.
We have allowed a lot of deregulation. The Wall Street Journal suggests that we have not benefited from it. Is it your sense that we have clearly we have a challenge here, but in terms of just cost, have we benefited in lower cost? And I know that's a big question when you start adding costs together, but any quick thoughts, and let's move on to solutions.
I mean, it seems like it, you know, to be able to cut corners or to, you know, to follow a certain ideology, and markets can work, but with guardrails and with a, you know, clearer hand to make them work. In this case, it seemed like it was saving us money the past, you know, 3 years when our wholesale prices were averaging, you know, 20 something bucks a megawatt hour. And then you have a week like last week, and the cost of generation last week were as much as 3 years combined. And they left 40% of people in the dark. And, you know, they left, you know, so many, you know, hospitals without water, people, you know, freezing in their homes. So the cost of a single week offset any savings we got from cutting corners and not more carefully, you know, managing our markets in the past. You can have regulation, you can have deregulation. It's all about how well do you do it. And we did it very badly and it failed us.
Yeah, it's, I, good.
Awesome. There are many kinds of costs. There's financial costs, and most of us focus on the cost that we write the bills for, or lately the cost of us sitting in the dark cold with our water pipes bursting. But there are also costs associated with pollution. There's costs associated with old infrastructure. And there's a bunch of other costs. And I want to point out that, yes, the costs of the past week have been disastrous. But A, we saved a heck of a lot of money in the years before this. B, we were, because of the structure of our market, we were able to bring, to replace a massive amount of old, polluting, inefficient coal and natural gas generation with extraordinarily clean, productive wind and solar generation, and now more and more storage. And that has not happened in a lot of other places. So the ability of our markets to bring in that kind of new technology has been incredibly valuable for Texans as a whole, and is going to pay off long-term. We have also spent a great deal of money expanding our transmission and distribution infrastructure. Not enough. We could do a lot more, but the way that we set up this market enabled a lot of technology investment, and it enabled a lot of creativity in how we deliver electric products to customers, and a lot of customers have benefited from that. So yes, this past week has been disastrous from cost, but there's a lot of other benefits that we've received besides low electric prices.
Yeah, and the Energy Information Administration puts Texas 43 out of 50 in terms of average retail cost. And one would be the highest cost across the states, and 50 would be the lowest. So we are in the lower part of that. I mean, we do need to consider all these other costs, but it's like, you know, and then I do want to take a more look at the data that the Wall Street Journal put out today. I haven't had a chance to look at it just yet, but I mean, that is where we sit in the ranking of states currently.
Their methodology was not disclosed, but we're eager to see it. Let's move on to solutions, and I know we're going to run out of time. And so again, thank you for your willingness to be here. Questions that have come in, and I'm going to throw them all out at once, and would like to talk about solutions. Is the market broken in Texas? Is this a market problem? Do we need to interconnect into the national grid? We have some direct current ties already. Is that a direction that lawmakers should be looking? What solutions will prevent this from happening going forward?
So, I mean, there's been a lot of folks talk about, would a capacity market have helped? Like, you know, would different types of, you know, different market structures have helped? And maybe if somehow they had led us to plan for better events and think more cross-cutting across the gas and the electricity sector. I mean, if that were the case, then perhaps. But it's like, because we have separate regulators for those different parts, it's not clear to me that it necessarily, you know, would have. And reasonable people can disagree with me on that, and that's fine. As far as like connections across, I mean, we had neighbors that were also struggling. So SPP, or the Southern Power Pool, basically Oklahoma up to North Dakota, you know, they were having issues, not as bad as ours. Louisiana was having issues as well. I think they're still maybe having some issues, Louisiana, Mississippi, et cetera. So if for that to have been meaningfully helpful, I think we would have had to have had we'd have to go big or go home. It would have to be coast to coast at that point. Like, we would need a national level, maybe transmission network that was a third layer on top of the ISO RTO thing we have going on right now. So it's, you know, it's kind of like maybe a little wouldn't have done much, but maybe a lot could have helped a little.
I think those are both important questions, so I'd like to address both. On the market side, I've been calling this the ERCOT casino. This is forcing power generators to basically sell their power for lottery tickets. And most of the time it's worth $20. Sometimes it's worth negative. When it's really windy, sometimes it's worth $9,000. And they never know how many of those $9,000 jackpots they're gonna get before a season. And so it's really hard to prepare what makes the most sense. And this might make sense to, you know, a free market purist, or to a economic theorist, or to an ideologue, but who ignores inequities, who ignores justice, who ignores the risk that it's putting so many companies and business through, who ignores the environment. But it's, in my opinion, failing us as Texans. On the second question about connecting in, we've made this decision that dates back to the 1930s to run an isolated grid to keep the feds out of our business. And Rick Perry said we would rather put up with a few days of blackouts to keep the feds out of our business. I think most people just want to keep the lights on and aren't theorists of state versus federal policy. And so that decision, I don't think many people I know would rather keep the lights on than have a market theory. If we had more ties to other grids, it wouldn't have helped us much in the first hours of this crisis, because other places were being slammed by that same Arctic blast. It would have helped us get the lights on back quicker this time. But I think this shows the importance of not just fighting the last battle, or not just fighting the last blast, because 9 out of 10 of our next crises are probably going to come in the summer, a hurricane, a drought, a heat wave, a flood. And in those cases, those are a bit more localized, and we would really benefit. We would really get out of those crises by bringing power in. Plus we have all the mild springs and falls in between when it's really windy and really sunny. And it would be in our best interest to be able to export some of our power to other states. So we're hurting ourselves year round. And if we just look at would it have helped the first 2 hours of this storm, we're gonna be missing the decisions that would prevent the future crises and that would profit us around the year.
I'd like to turn to two different solutions that I believe are much more effective, not just for market, that it will be affect operational things and have a much greater equity benefit than big lofty issues like should we change our market. The first is that consistent with my comments and those of my colleagues that extreme weather events and risks are here to stay. We cannot protect the grid from everything. We can't keep it. We can't keep Texans' lights on. We cannot afford to spend the money to protect everything and to harden everything. There will always be more hurricanes and heat waves and ice storms and whatever going forward. We need to protect Texans aggressively against inevitable grid failures, regardless of the cause. And the best way to do that is very aggressive energy efficiency, distributed generation, clean photovoltaics, distributed battery storage, and the like. And the first place to start is very aggressive, ambitious home energy efficiency retrofits for low-income customers and multifamily housing, because those are the places that you can, that will never be able to do energy efficiency on their own. We need very aggressive forward-looking energy efficiency standards and building codes for all new construction in Texas. And we need aggressive investment in things like community solar and storage, because all of those things will help us be resilient at the individual and community level when the inevitable bad stuff happens, whether it's a hurricane or a cyber attack. Beyond that, another very practical thing that would have made a difference for so many of us last week is that all the distribution companies should be re-examining and drastically changing their outage management systems, and very specifically their rotating block outage criteria and the equipment by which they do that. They didn't rotate outages because the critical facility blocks are so large, with folks like me who sit next to a hospital, that entire downtowns were lit up while everywhere around them was sitting in the dark. And so what we need is sectionalization and distribution equipment and remote access that allows much smaller and more surgical sectionalization and outaging, so that you can actually rotate the burden of sitting in the dark between many people, rather than just have most of us sitting around for 4 days straight without power.
Anna had asked a question about how we work to make sure these disasters don't affect frontline communities. Dan, you made reference to equity. Allison, you made reference to weatherization and energy efficiency. I think we have all discovered how energy inefficient our homes are from losing our heat. But there are millions of Texans who don't have the means to weatherize, but that efficiency would have lowered the demand for electricity on our grid on a larger scale. We would have, that would have helped.
Exactly. The more that we can reduce load, the more we create slack for grid operators and the supply side to do the things they do, and the more that we create time for the transition to intermittent technologies and new grid management techniques to operate. So efficiency has 1,000 benefits, and the costs of it are paid back very quickly in terms of personal safety and grid safety.
Weatherization would help us all, especially on the water side. I mean, the big reason that the water went out was because so many pipes were busting. And so that was, you know, cutting the water pressure throughout the system. The people most vulnerable to that, the people who probably don't have the means to, you know, make those few $100 investments to better insulate their pipes. If there's a weatherization program, I know the Biden administration has talked about investing in weatherization. If that can go beyond just the typical electricity and insulation and other things, but also go to be sure that we protect against these water outages will help people better withstand the storm, even if it takes some incentives or just outright doing, whatever can be done in that way can pay off, five or tenfold over by helping our whole system work better and by protecting people from, from the suffering that they really went through in this storm.
Yeah, and Jeff, one of the things I just add real fast, we've got to be talking about weatherization of power plants. All generation does need to be looking at its weatherization practices and what are the best practices. But as we do that, just saying we've got to weatherize everything, we've got to be sure that we are smart with regard to what we do, because Texas also has real high heat, and some weatherization initiatives can actually reduce the ability of power plants to operate in that high heat. So we've got to have a Texas approach with regard to weatherization. The point that Allison made with regard to distributed generation cannot be overlooked. There's folks that I've talked to that have had hundreds of customers who had their own generation and storage that were able to weather this storm with warmth in their home, even as the distribution grid had gone down. So there's a lot more attention that needs to be paid to encouraging people to be able to be self-reliant and to install microgrids, install self-generation, install self-storage, and not discourage it as some regulatory structures do.
We're going to run out of time. I want to be respectful of you, our panelists, and I know we still have a very large audience with us. So if you'll indulge me for just a couple more minutes. We have an energy mix that focuses on reliability, on the environment, on cost, and we pair a lot of resources together to deliver on all of those promises. We have a systemic failure to get fuel to the plants that needed it, to weatherize plants of all types. We have water issues, we have fuel issues, we have generation issues, we have weatherization, energy efficiency, distributed generation, lots of solutions. To let us wrap up, I'll just offer each of you an opportunity to summarize. If you were making recommendations to lawmakers, and I know there are a few with us here today, if you were making recommendations to the legislature and lawmakers, what do we do and how do we keep keep Texas competitive as a leader in energy, but also as a leading economic light in the country?
I mean, I think, there's two timescales there. There's one, we have to make sure that this doesn't happen in the short term, because, the fact of the matter is, if we had the same storm in 2 weeks, like, we could do better communication, but we'd be in the same boat, unfortunately. So, we need to figure out in the short term, what are the things we do about, smart winterization, as we've looked at. But in the long term, we need to be planning better. Like, we need to, we need to be taking these formerly low probability, maybe moving into medium probability issues and considering them as we, go forward so that we can keep people's lights on.
We need our electricity system to do four things for us. We need it to be affordable. We need it to be reliable. We need it to be environmentally sustainable, and we need it to be resilient to bounce back when there's a disaster. And I think what we've seen in this instance is that there's been a focus on affordability above all else, and actually to the actual loss of affordability if you tally the costs of this, and we haven't considered all four of those. And the only way we're going to satisfy all four of those needs is with a portfolio, with a team. And if we're knocking any one source, saying that wind couldn't have kept this up all the time, or gas couldn't have carried the whole load, if we don't look at this as a team and realize that the roles that each of these plays, that if we knock wind or solar because they were only a sliver at that one peak hour of demand, we'll miss the ways that they're affecting all four of those and benefiting all four of those all throughout the year and in other types of crises. And we need to think about how do we build this. We have a system right now that, for all its growth in wind and solar, was still counting on a single fuel with a very specific vulnerability to be two-thirds of the load at the time when we need it most. We need to be branching out. We need to make each of those individual players more resilient and more robust, and we need to be diversifying and seeing how these team players can better work together.
And that diversification is important. ERCOT has been open for new technology and new ideas coming in. We've got new technologies coming down the pipe, like hydrogen, that's getting a lot of discussion. New energy storage technologies that could really change the dynamic. We don't need to just say, oh, well, we got to go back to the old way of doing things because that's the safe and way to do it. No, we really need to continue to be open for continued diversification of our resources because that can be very important. And I think, you know, there's been a lot of discussion with regard to the interconnection issues. There really does need to be some discussion with regard to that. And look at, are there smart ways that we could bring some additional power in, you know, like Josh said, from farther away. And there are people that have been working on those very issues, and those are things that need to continue.
And last, we have talked about solving the electricity problem as though it's only an electricity system. The system that we are talking about, that when you say, how do we fix electricity, that's this big. But the problem that we experienced is this big. It's about many more. It's about water, transportation, gas, and most important, about customers. And none of us have talked enough about equity. And so we need to be doing things that put Texans and people first and address the equity implications of all of these related systems and failures, and think about how do we help people on the people side, because they're the most important part of the electric system, and they're the victims if we screw up electricity and gas and water and transportation and all of those other things. So if your only goal is to solve the electric problem, you're going to fail. So think much bigger, and don't waste all of our time and attention with this silly look for villains and blaming. Let's start figuring out how to solve meaningful problems with meaningful solutions on a much broader scale. Thanks.
Thank you, Allison. Dan, Josh, Michael, Allison, thank you so much for sharing your time with us. I know that the ERCOT board meeting is starting. We're beginning to lose our audience, and I know that we need to get there as well. And I just want to thank you, Conservative Texans for Energy Innovation, Matt Welch and crew, thank you for helping do this event with us. Thank you to New West Communication. If there are reporters who want to make contact with any of our panelists, you can contact Steve Scheibel, New West Communications, and he will connect you. Again, this has been a tremendous event. I think it's been very valuable to the dialogue. And we will be posting this to the internet on our YouTube and on our websites. It'll be available for those who want to go back and review it again or to watch it for the first time. So again, thank you to all four of you. I very much, and the state very much appreciates your expertise as we improve and go forward from here.